So lately, been wondering who will be there to take my place when I'm gone. You'll need love to light the shadows on your face. If a great wave shall fall and fall upon us all, then between the sand and stone, could you make it on your own? If I could, then I would. I'll go wherever you will go. Way up high or down low, I'll go wherever you will go. And maybe I'll find out a way to make it back someday, towards you, to guide you the darkest of your day.
All right, guys, we'll go ahead and get started. First off, can everybody hear me okay? All right, sounds good. So thanks for everybody for joining the ninth installment of the Unity Band Seeker Session. I'm happy to have everybody here on the line. By way of introduction, I'm John Sharippa, president and founder, and we've got a good mix of folks here. You know, the Unity Band's community, volunteers, donors, family members, friends. So thanks for joining us. We are recording tonight's session. I appreciate you guys jumping on Google Meet. This is the first time we've done Meet versus Zoom. So we're just kind of working through the IT challenges. But this is going to be our new platform because it gives us some more capabilities that we didn't have with the free Zoom option. So other than that, I'll have some announcements at the end, but I would recommend everybody just mute your mics. And then I think Ruth and Mohammed are going to take questions at the end of the talk. So as I kind of turn things over to them, you know, during the pandemic, what you saw was a lot of different nonprofits struggling, but then there were also nonprofits and community organizations that sprung up during the pandemic to respond to the need of the community. And when I discovered what Ruth and Mohammed were doing, it was really profound and what they have going on even to this day, as the national attention and the public emergency has ended, really making sure that, you know, the stories remain. So with that, Ruth, Mohammed, I'll turn things over to you guys.
Sure. Thank you so much, John. And thanks for giving us the opportunity to talk with you and introduce ourselves to your Unity Band's audience. My name is Ruth Nasrullah, and I'm the co-founder and secretary treasurer of COVID-19 Wall of Memories, which is a 501c3 nonprofit. It's a virtual memorial. Our mission is to memorialize people who've passed away due to COVID and to educate the public about COVID in all its aspects. And so we have a virtual memorial. We have a little over, Mohammed, is it like 20,600, something in that neighborhood, people memorialized on the Wall of Memories. And we also have a blog for the education component, and we've done different activities like vaccination drives. We did care packages, for healthcare workers, for the ICU nurses at a local hospital during the height of the pandemic. We were formed in 2020. And I am going to let Mohammed take it from there to tell us a little bit about how it came about, what we do.
So I want to thank John and your organization for giving us the opportunity to talk about this really important project that Ruth and I started way back in 2020. What happened is in 2020, in January, February, and March of 2020, we were seeing this news about COVID-19 infections and hospitalizations and people people passing away from this virus. It was always numbers and numbers, and we just said that, you know, there are people behind all these numbers, and we would hear about some local folks in our own community getting infected, getting hospitalized, and in, you know, and passing away. So by the time April and May of 2020 came around, the number of people who had died in our country was 100,000, and we felt like we needed to do something, take action, and do something about this. And we basically just brainstormed and, you know, wrote down what we envisioned to be needed to be done to remember these people, honor them, and memorialize them. And based on our ideas, we decided that it had to be a virtual memorial, and with other component of educating the public about this virus. So based on all those ideas, we hired a website developing company, and it took us almost like 6 months or so to develop this virtual memorial and all the other aspects of the website that we have, and which was officially launched on the 4th of January of 2021. And today, like Ruth said, we have honored 20,600 of our fellow countrymen on this memorial. And the memorial is a virtual memorial. It has pictures. It's similar to the Vietnam Memorial, except it has pictures of the people who have died of COVID-19. And below the picture, there's a profile button that you can click on it, and it will take you to their story. I know what their date of birth is, when they died, what they did, a little bit, a snippet about the story. And then below that, there's a space for friends and family and visitors to leave messages. And Ruth can tell us about all the other aspects of our website.
Sure. And of the 20,600 or so people that we have memorialized on the wall, they represent two different sources where we get these stories from. We do go to the internet and find obituaries of people who passed away from COVID, and we excerpt those on our site. We don't use the entire obituary for a couple of reasons. The families who lost loved ones are the center and the focus of everything we do. So when we stopped and thought about it, if we took and copied and pasted an entire obituary, the families didn't write that obituary for our site. So we excerpt it, put the link, and if you want to know more about that person, you can go click the link and go to the obituary. The other way is that people who've lost loved ones to COVID can submit the stories through a form on our site themselves. And we really want to start increasing the number of people who are submitting stories of their loved ones. And we call them stories as opposed to, you know, records or entries, because that's what we want this to be, is the stories of people who died of COVID and their families and friends. And so we really want to ramp that up because, you know, as John alluded to, there's sort of, we've kind of passed through the crisis, you know, this most scary phase of COVID, but it's still here. And the people that we lost are still gone, and the families who grieve them still grieve. And so we want to have more of their voices, their stories reflected on our site and reflected on the wall of memories. And to that end, as Mohammed mentioned, there's also an educational component. We have a blog. We started the website with sort of like a news site, a news page, and it's evolved into a blog, which covers a bunch of different aspects of COVID and everyday life and CDC guidance. But also we have an ongoing series, my favorite, is the Pandemic Motherhood Diary. And it's a writer who had two children during the pandemic, and she writes from so many different aspects, what life is like raising her kids in the pandemic. So I'm really proud of that. And that's sort of the entirety of what we do. And I mean, I know, John, your focus is very much on healthcare workers. We have hundreds of healthcare workers, unfortunately, honored on the wall of memories. You know, unfortunately, they lost their lives in numbers. So, you know, we made sure to remember them. And then Mohammed, I don't know if you want to talk a little bit about what it means, you know, to be, keep telling the story of COVID-19 in America. And I will preface it by saying, as far as I know, we are the longest lasting COVID memorial. You know, a lot of them sprang up in 2020, 2021, but we've been around for several years and we're still dedicated to doing what we do. So given that, Mohammed, if you want to talk a little bit about why it's important to keep telling that story.
There's been so many, announcement that the pandemic is over and people are relaxing their requirements of social distancing or not wearing a mask or things like that. But if you pay attention to the infection rates or people who are still passing away because of COVID, it has not gone away. There's still so many people who are getting infected and who are passing away from this terrible disease, that I think we need to continue our work, and we feel like it's really important for us to keep offering or memorializing and remembering all these folks who are still getting impacted, not just the victims but the families of the victims that are being impacted, and the original purpose of, you know, the people behind the numbers, is it still valid?
Unfortunately.
Yeah, and I don't know, Ruth can talk about how this our project has been archived in the U.S. Library of Congress. You want to talk about that?
Yeah, that was actually, it was something that happened in 2021, I believe. And I got an email from the Library of Congress from out of nowhere saying that our site is archived in the Library of Congress's coronavirus, I think it's called the Coronavirus Archive, something like that. So that's a great honor that we enjoy. And I think that another aspect of our work is that the stories still need to be told because they're changing. COVID grief, I think, has really changed, because when we talk to people and when we see the stories that they share, deaths from COVID in 2020 were very different from deaths from COVID in 2024 in some ways. The people that, because we've met many of the people that have submitted their loved one's story on the wall of memories, and they weren't able to have to gather for a memorial service. They weren't able to be in the room with the loved one, their loved one when they died. All of that, you know, things that were happening in 2020 and 2021, thankfully, it's not the same. But I feel, and I've actually found some, I'm a journalist, so I like think I got to go check references and everything. And I found some studies that actually do show that COVID grief, it has a little bit different characteristics than grief from other causes of death. And I find also that has changed a little bit as people are sort of, you know, as the precautions are being relaxed and the CDC, you know, the state of the emergency ended and all of that, still people are dying, but it's a different sort of atmosphere. It's a different sort of set of circumstances. And so that's also part of the story of COVID-19 in America. It's more even than just the disease. By us memorializing people, we are telling the public what it's like to know someone who died of COVID in the United States at different periods of time in different settings. So I just find that really interesting. And as I said, we know, you know, we've interacted with a lot of the people who have submitted their own loved one story on the wall. And I actually, last night, we had a surprise birthday party for my husband, and we had several people there who had lost people to COVID who were, you know, our honored guests. So it's a sad story to tell, but I also think it's a great story to tell. And I think that COVID-19 Wall of Memories tells it well. So, Mohammed, did we want to, do you have anything else to say? We also wanted to show the...
I would like to show you how simple it is to, for anyone who has lost a loved one to this terrible disease, to come to our website and share their loved one story. So I'm going to share my screen, John, with the audience here. Okay, here we go. All right, so this is the virtual memorial that we have talked about. And if you don't do anything, if you just go there, land here, this memorial, or this, what you're seeing, scroll from right to left, just like it did, every 15 seconds. And then you can, you know, go to any of these pictures, and then right below you see the view profile, and it takes you to the story. But what I'm going to show you is right up here on the top bar, there's a menu item which says share your loved one story. You just click on that, and it takes you to a couple disclaimers here. You just click on that. It basically, the disclaimers are really asking you to agree that what you're gonna about to share is true to the best of your knowledge, and you agree to allow us to share it on this memorial. So you click on that, it next, and this opens up a small form where you type in your loved one's details, like the first name, the last name, your email address. This is all your information, and then your loved one's story is where it begins, the first name, the middle name, last name, and you just go on, add all the details that it's asking you to do, you know, type in your story, and you upload a picture of your loved one here, and you just double check everything, and then you just click on this thing which says I'm not a robot, and submit it. It takes like less than 5 minutes for you to submit that, and then you're done, and it comes to me as a let's see, where did it go?
Can I just make a comment about, you know, the field where you write the story? Some people copy and paste, you know, the formal obituary that was written for the loved one that they lost. But some people write very personalized and, you know, very moving stories of their own, just talking about their loved one, things that they did, that sort of thing. So, Mohammed, go ahead.
Yeah, so it's that simple. Once you submit it, it comes to me as an administrator of that portion of the website, and I just go through it, make sure everything checks, and we publish it, and that your loved one is honored on the memorial, and then we send an email out to the person who shared the loved one story, and telling them that this is all already done, it's honored, and here's a link to their loved one story, and they can share that link with family and friends and invite them to visit that profile, that story, and leave messages, or, you know, it's fairly simple, and we always want to be given the opportunity to honor your loved one if you or somebody you know has lost somebody to COVID.
And you know, we're proud that we've been doing this for, you know, four years now, 3 years now. And I think that it's also really important because, again, as I said, even though COVID has changed, through these stories, we can remember that we lived through a time that was unlike any other in 100 years. Who among us ever thought that we would live through, you know, a worldwide pandemic? So when we look at these stories, we can remember that. So that's part of why we think it's really important to keep telling the story of COVID-19 in America. John.
Thank you both. By the way, for the Vigoritas and the Sharipas on the call, when I found out about COVID-19 Wall of Memories, I added Peter Caserta's story on there. So Peter is featured on the wall. Does anybody on the call have a question? I know I have one, but I wanted to open up to the group.
Oh.
All right, Ruth, I'll get you started here. So, you know, I know every story is impactful, but is there, you know, over the course of the last 2+ years that you guys have been doing this, is there a story that, you know, that really sticks out and really just, you know, shines?
I mean, there's several. One in particular that is very close to our hearts is a grandma, an abuela, whose family, they have come back time and time again to leave messages, almost as though they're visiting a grave site. And they talk about such personal things, you know, about the, she loved to sit and eat candy bars and drink, you know, strong coffee and that sort of thing, all those little details. So that's really important to us. And then, I don't know, Mohammed, maybe Lisa and her son.
Yeah, Lisa Witten and her son.
Mm-hmm. He was 23, I believe, when he passed away. And she also had a disabled mom that she took care of. So she was in a really difficult situation. And she's among the people that we have kept in touch with. She's also in our area. We're based in Houston. And they actually appeared, my husband and Lisa appeared on a talk show, a local station, to talk about both COVID-19 Wall of Memories and what she experienced losing someone. There are also some children, unfortunately, who are honored on the Wall of Memories, and that's always sad to see. But again, they're compelling stories that remind us what we've been through.
There's literally, this is something that it has really touched me, as there's literally hundreds of couples.
Yes.
Hundreds of couples who have passed away within minutes of each other. Both you know, both husband and wife got COVID, and there's at least one that I know, right, here in Texas, where they both died holding their hands in the same ICU room, and it is so touching to see that these couples who were married for like 50 years or 60 years and, you know, just passing away. It's really very, very touching to read their stories.
And I would also say about those couples that quite a few of them, they have photos, you know, that depict the couple, the obituaries, maybe, you know, combine the two of them. And that, you see from that the impact visually of the Wall of Memories as you're watching all those little boxes with the faces in there, and you see these couples, and then it scrolls again and you see couples, but there's two because we do an entry for each person, the husband and wife. So you see these two, and it just really visually reinforces the impact.
Yeah. And Ruth, you want to talk about English, the one from Arizona?
Yeah. Yeah, she's a young lady who actually died of, I forget the name of it, but there's an illness that was kind of more prevalent in children that was a result of COVID infection. And she was 11 or 12 when she died. They lived out in Arizona. And, you know, her mom reached out to us. That's another one that, you know, we've kept in touch with them since they submitted her story. And yeah, it's just really, it's heartbreaking, you know, to see what they've gone through. Very sad.
Okay. Anybody else with questions? And we already have a question, and you might be on mute.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Yes. I just want to comment on Ruth and Mohammed. Thank you for doing that work. It's very beautiful.
Automated voice messaging system.
Oh, I don't know what that is.
Is not available.
Okay.
John, please record your message. When you finish recording, you may hang up or press 1 for.
You're doing such beautiful work.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank You're you so welcome. Much.
It's a lot of work. I understand that.
It is. He stays up late. Nothing goes on the website without us approving it. And he's in charge of, you know, going through those every night. And I don't even know how late he stays up some nights, but working on that. Yeah. And
families are very appreciative as well that you do it for.
Yeah. Mm.
Yeah. The only ask that we have, we don't charge any money, we don't act, we do take donations to, you know, keep the take care of the operating costs, but the only ask that we have is if you or somebody you know who have lost a loved one, please give us the opportunity to honor them on the wall, and you would like you to share this virtual memorial, the website, with your family, friends, followers, just to invite people to come and visit this memorial.
And it's COVID-19wallofmemories.org.
Yeah, it's very simple. Yeah, COVID-19wallofmemories.org.
Okay, last call. And Pat, you got a question? All right, I thought I saw her hand raised.
Yes, she did raise her hand, I think.
Yeah, Patricia, maybe you're muted.
Yeah, her mic is off. So this happens on Google Meet too, not just Zoom.
Yeah, it's even harder on Google Meet because now you got to figure out where the mute button
exactly.
is.
Exactly. Yeah, we're all used to Zoom.
All right. While we fix that, I did. So first off, Mohammed and Ruth, thank you for doing the work that you're doing, for so many years now. And, for joining us for this call, for the Unity Bands community, just kind of what's coming up here in the future. I dropped the link to the survey in the chat window. We have some guest speakers coming up in April and May. For example, we have a doctor here at the Baltimore Washington Medical Center who's going to be talking about long COVID. And then we have Dr. Diabundo from Seton Hall University talking about the studies that her and her team are currently doing regarding it's health administration related, but it's basically taking a look at data for folks that are in the healthcare field. And basically, the lack of knowledge that healthcare workers had during the pandemic about how to take care of themselves. So health illiteracy among healthcare workers. They have some initial findings, but they're spending the next couple months analyzing and collecting data. So they're going to be able to brief the results of those studies for our speaker session. Meanwhile, we have the March date open. We don't have a speaker date for the March session. So if you know anybody interested in speaking at one of these, please let me know. But other than that, I think that's pretty much it. Ruth and Mohammed, thanks again, and everybody have a great night.
Thank you. Yeah. You too. Thanks for having me.
Thank you all.
Okay. Bye.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
I just wanted to add that it's such a beautiful service that you provide. It's from a personal point of view, you know, from experience, I belong to a group called Compassionate Friends, and it is so important for parents and loved ones to see the pictures of the loved ones that have transitioned or they've lost, and and to read memories from other people, what they it's just an incredible wonderful thing that you provide. And I just wondered, do you also provide any other grief counseling, where they can go to deal to, you know, to heal their grief? There's so many wonderful, you know, places out there that help them, but just what you do is really important. I just wondered what the, is there follow-up or?
We don't do, you know, any counseling or have, you know, a grief and, you know, thank God we didn't lose anyone to COVID. So we're not personally involved in any grief groups, but I know there are a lot of Facebook groups out there, and if people ask, we will certainly, you know, direct them how to get help, but we're not counselors and we haven't experienced the loss. But I will say, as I mentioned, you know, there's several of the people who've shared their loved one's story that we're friends with, and we know the things that they were going through. And as I said, some of them were at Mohammed's birthday party last night. So, you know, and I think that even that is very helpful, you know, like Lisa that we mentioned has a rough time of it, and she will call us up, you know, but we're by no means are we trying to be counselors, Mohammed.
Yeah.
But just the fact that you get to reminisce and talk about your loved ones with friends, it's really, really vital to healing.
Yep.
You know, I just want to take a minute to add something. There's several families who treat this memorial as a place to visit on the day of their loved one dying or dead. It's really like visiting a cemetery. They come and visit on those days and on special days, and it's really I feel like this memorial is helping them, you know, find some peace and some closure.
That's true. Thank you.
Also, you know, we had Chris Kotcher, the executive director of COVID Survivors for Change, on the speaker session a couple months ago, and he was talking about one of the services that they offer is like a weekly session for survivors to get together and talk and how to cope and network. So yeah, so there are some good resources that are out there.
Definitely. Thanks.
All right, all. Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.